Good evening. Thank you all for coming. Tonight we have the privilege of hearing John Thiessen, and probably he's familiar to everyone, but we'll just give you a little more information to let you know that he is a graduate of Wichita State University's graduate program and has done graduate studies at the University of Kansas, and he is our archivist, so he oversees a very important collection for us, and he's also the co-director of libraries here at Bethel College. And in looking at John's CV, he has a very rich wealth of research work that he has done in some Mennonite publications and some non-Mennonite publications, and they all seem to have kind of a historical theme to them, so this seems to fall pretty well in that setting. And interestingly, when Nathan and I asked for the potential presenters to send us a little abstract and kind of tell us a little bit about what they were planning on presenting, John dutifully sent one in. In fact, his was the first in. He was the most prompt. And included in this little abstract was the word metonym. I didn't know what a metonym was. I'm still not sure I exactly understand what a metonym is. So I've already learned something from John because I had to go look up what does metonym mean. And I like roots of languages, so I'm digging around in, you know, in Merriam-Webster's metonym, and I find, well, it comes from the word metonymy, and I think, okay, great, now there's two words. I don't know what they mean. Well, metonymy is a compound of meta and anim. So we're going back to Greek. And meta, you know, metabolize, metastasize, you know, it's one of those prefix things that we often stick onto words of Greek origin. And it can be a prefix, or it can just signify that it's kind of an abstract idea. And anim, gnome, name. So metonym, we're talking about kind of abstracting about a name of something, which makes it sound a whole lot better than my first original thought, which was, I bet it means mascot. So I like metonym better. So we're talking about the Thresher. And so in looking up, you know, this all doing all this work just so that I can actually understand what this word means that John has used, which just proves that 5 university degrees don't really mean that much, because I had never encountered this word before. It's defined as a figure of speech consisting of the use of a name of one thing for that of another. It is an attribute or with which it is associated. So when we talk about a thresher and metonyms, we can be talking about an association or an attribute. Now, first of all, I would like to really applaud the facilities people we have at Bethel College, because they got this thing up here. I don't know how they got this thing up here, but they got this thing up here. This is a big rock with a bunch of lumps. So I'm hoping that when we talk about threshers, we're talking about association and not attributes. I generally don't think of my students as big lumping things with, you know, lots of bumps. But when we do talk about thresher, we are talking about alumni, current students, and not those things that separate the grain from the chaff. So this has been just in just getting the faculty seminar flyer together an enlightening experience for me, expanded my horizons. So I am counting on John to enlighten us in lots of other ways by explaining to us some more about Bethel history and where we got the thresher from and why we're no longer the gray maroons. John?
Well, thought I would start with a text in the sort of traditional mode. I wonder if anyone has Isaiah 41:15 memorized in the King James Version. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains and beat them small, and shalt make the hills as chaff. Here at Bethel, we've paid a lot of attention to athletics over the last few years with the Thresher Stadium as a manifestation of that. But we've taken for granted our basic symbolism. Bethel teams became the Threshers well within living memory, but strangely that change has been completely forgotten, as has much else in Bethel's history since about 1950. Penny Moon, when she came here to teach history in 2002, sensed a lack of something in Bethel's corporate culture. She asked, "Where are your traditions?" Here's a tradition which has been forgotten, and I hope with this talk to recover a little of it, what we can of it. To thresh means, as the Oxford English Dictionary puts it, to separate by any mechanical means, e.g. rubbing, shaking, trampling, stamping, beating, or intermittent pressure, the grains of any cereal from the husks and straw, especially by beating with a flail, now from the latter part of the 18th century, also by the action of revolving mechanism in a mill or machine. Also, the verb was in early times applied to the trampling and stamping of oxen or the dragging of heavy, rugged things. Yes, the OED actually used the word thing in that context. Heavy, rugged things over grain laid on a smooth surface or floor. Thresh is closely related to the word thrash, and in fact, in the OED, the words thresh, threshing, etc., appear under the head word thrash, which comes from an ancient Indo-European word for making a rattling noise. And to thrash, of course, means to beat completely or thoroughly. Thus, threshers is a suitably violent image for an athletic symbol. Threshers gestures to a pioneering spirit and other cliches of an agricultural heritage. Being threshers is distinctive. I don't know of any other threshers in college or high school sports. There is a minor league baseball team called the Threshers, but they are named after a variety of sharks, so that's not an agricultural metaphor. We stand out from all the lions, tigers, bears, warriors, and other worn-out commonplaces of athletic symbolism. Some of our neighbors, of course, are also distinctive. The Wichita State Shockers, for example, or the Heston High School Swathers also make use of agricultural references. It's interesting, these agricultural metaphors are all harvest related. You don't have plows or seed drills or manure spreaders, but threshers, swathers, and shockers. And they're all pre-industrial. There are no combines or tractors. The Newton High School Railroaders, or railers as it has come to be shortened, do make a fairly rare industrial connection. And then some symbolism systems seem to lack the necessary violent spirit. The Heston College Larks, which reminds me of an old Monty Python sketch about the Wizzo Chocolate Factory, or the Gossel Bluebirds, or the St. Mary Spires. And what about some of the other Mennonite colleges? They're the Tabor Blue Jays. You know, you've observed real blue jays, noisy and intrusive. The Goshen College Maple Leafs, not leaves, but leafs, L-E-A-F-S, that seems a little mysterious. The Bluffton University Beavers, and their website shows a very mean-looking beaver. And Eastern Mennonite University is the Royals, which apparently is an unimaginative reference to school colors. Fresno Pacific University is the Sunbirds, you know, sort of the cliche of sunny California. You can find another, you know, other distinctive or odd symbols nearby among some of our neighbors. The Bethany Swedes or the Inman Teutons, ethnic symbolism. Southwestern Mound Builders, where in the world does that come from? One favorite of mine is the Clinton, Oklahoma Tornadoes. It seems like tempting fate, doesn't it? But really one of the best ones I've run across is the Pius XI High School in Milwaukee, which has the Pius Popes and, of course, the Lady Popes. which, you know, there's something wrong with that there. So there's no shortage, really, of odd symbols out there. And speaking of odd, coming back from that little bit of a digression, you have the gray maroons, the Bethel gray maroons. Until spring 1960, Bethel teams were called the gray maroons. Now, obviously, this comes from the school colors, which were chosen by the senior class in 1907. In April 1907, the Bethel College Monthly, the regular publication of the college at that time, said, quote, "The maroon and the gray have now been definitely adopted as the college colors, and a number of the students will provide themselves with pennants. Why can we not also have a good college song? Where is our poet?" End quote. The alma mater by music professor Albert D. Schmutz wasn't written until 1916. Unfortunately, nobody recorded anything more about how maroon and gray were chosen. We wish we knew more in this centennial year. There's nothing in faculty or board minutes or any further explanation in college publications. And the change from gray maroons to threshers has also been almost completely forgotten. And I want to bring back to our consciousness what I've been able to find out. The symbolism of the threshing stone actually has a long history at Bethel, back to about the same time as the school colors, a century ago or a little bit more. In spring 1903, C.H. Wedel, the first president of Bethel, and Max's great-great-grandfather, Barry's third cousin, five times removed, C.H. Wedel reportedly set up a threshing stone in his front yard. The Bethel College Monthly of June 1903 was a bit bemused in its tone. Quote, "Professor C.H. Wedel recently acquired an interesting relic in the shape of an old threshing stone, such as were formerly in general use in Russia. This valuable relic of former agricultural methods now occupies a prominent place in Professor Wedel's yard, but there is little danger that anyone will carry it away," end quote. The stone came from Wedel's father-in-law, Heinrich Rickert's farm, and the house and yard where Wedel displayed it sat over where the Fine Arts Center is now. The stone might have been sitting on the grassy area just to the east of the Fine Arts Center. And that house was moved in 1963 over to 201 West 27th, so the house is still around in the neighborhood also. And actually, there's some chance that this is the stone that was set up there. There are a couple of possible candidates. This might be it. Threshing stones like this came into use among Mennonites in what was then part of the Russian Empire, today part of Ukraine, in the early 1840s. This is probably the earliest visual depiction of our kind of threshing stone in Ukraine in the early 1850s. According to David H. Rickert, who taught mathematics and astronomy here at Bethel for many years and is remembered as Uncle Davy, one of the great personalities of Bethel's history. He was C.H. Wedel's brother-in-law, actually, and Barry's second cousin, three times removed. According to Uncle Davy, threshing stones were used only on rye, not wheat, because rye straw was used as a roofing material, and threshing stones didn't break up the straw as much as other methods, such as flails or later threshing machines. Bundles of cut rye were laid out in a large circle, and horses pulled the stone around over the bundles, as you see in this illustration from the 1850s here. I don't know if any of you have ever heard a threshing stone being rolled around. It's very impressive sonically. This is the only early photo I've been able to find of a threshing stone in use. Unfortunately, there isn't any identification with the photo. I think it comes from Russia in the 1890s, but I don't really have anything more than that. And it's interesting, too, in that it's a double hitch of threshing stones. The stones that I've been able to measure are all remarkably similar, each with 7 teeth, 30 inches wide, an inner radius of 8.5 inches from the center to the base of the teeth, an outer radius of 12.5 inches from the center to the outer edge of the teeth. And these measurements match from stone to stone to within about 0.5 inch. I'd have a hypothesis about why they used 7 teeth and not some other number, but I won't go into that now. It doesn't really have anything to do with theological significance. It has more to do with physics and mechanics of the stone. These implements are made of limestone, which, as you know, is calcium carbonate. Limestone is a mineral that originated from various chemical and biological processes in oceanic environments. Kansas is packed full of limestone in various forms, laid down in prehistoric oceans that covered this area, including the chalk formations out in western Kansas, for example. On campus here, you see limestone everywhere. The ad building is made of it, and most of the other similar light-colored stone that you see around is limestone. Much of this building stone and the threshing stones were quarried in the Flint Hills in Marion and Chase counties, where there are still active quarries like this one just east of Florence. The limestone in the Flint Hills was laid down in the Permian period, which, as you remember from your study of geology, was 240 to 290 million years ago. And such limestones often include marine fossils and chunks of flint, which you can probably find with a close examination of the ad building if you wanted to climb around and look closely. When the Ukrainian Mennonites migrated here in the 1870s, they brought along wooden patterns for reproducing threshing stones. The Newton-Kansan in April 22, 1875 reported rather scornfully, "A carload of Mennonite threshing machines were unloaded at this place last week and conveyed to these farms north. They are manufactured at the rock quarries of Chase County and consist each of a large rock about 4 feet long and 2.5 in diameter, dressed the narrowest way in six-pointed star shape." Notice they got the dimensions and the number of teeth wrong. "A rod is placed in the end of each as a pivot and by which they are drawn over the grain in the manner of a wheel. We learn that these people have already invested $3,000, which would be over $50,000 in 2006 dollars, in these highly enlightened articles of agricultural machinery, which are not much better than the old manner of treading out grain." The Kansan editor was right to be somewhat scornful. Threshing stones were already on their way out, replaced by new industrial agricultural machinery, an area in which the Ukrainian Mennonites were some of the major innovators in Europe. So threshing stones were really only used for one generation. As early as 1878, observers reported threshing stones were largely abandoned in favor of new machinery. Even here in Kansas, they had become antiques or mementos. And they make pretty unwieldy antiques. Since we know the dimensions of the threshing stone, we can estimate how much one might typically weigh without picking it up and carrying it to the bathroom scale. Since they're more or less symmetrical rotationally, you can take sort of an average radius, which would be 10.5 inches, squared times pi times the length of 30 inches. I think you can do that all in your head. It gives you a volume of about 10,000 cubic inches, or about 5 3/4 cubic feet. Now, limestone varies a lot in density, but if we pick sort of a middling value of about 150 pounds per cubic foot, we get a weight of, say, 850 to 900 pounds, which, from what I know about the threshing stones, would be about right. Now that we've explored the materiality of the threshing stone, let's get back to the threshing stone as a linguistic trope, a metaphor or metonym or allegory or anagnorisis or something like that. C.H. Wedel's dragging a 900-pound memento into his front yard in 1903 was noted, but didn't really have any impact on the visual symbolism of the college. It wasn't until a generation later that threshing stones appear in the record again. On November 16, 1934, the threshing stone was adopted as the official symbol of Bethel College. This was sort of a mysterious decision, like many others. It's not mentioned in the faculty or board minutes. There are no news releases. Presumably, it was the decision of Edmund G. Kaufman, another memorable personality from Bethel's history, Dale Schrag's second cousin once removed, and also the same relationship to Dwight Crable and Richard Zerger. E.G. Kaufman had become president in 1932 and was energetically and vigorously molding the college. A note in the Collegian reported on a brief ceremony and two threshing stones, one of them, the one that had been in C.H. Wedel's yard, were placed in front of the old science hall on either side of the main door. apparently this was envisioned as a new tradition for the college, an annual freshman initiation ceremony at the Threshing Stones. But I don't know if it was ever repeated after this first 1934 gathering. The very limited reporting about the new symbol made explicit reference to the pioneering spirit and all those cliches. The 1936 yearbook, called The Gray Maroon, carried some photos of the event. There wasn't a 1935 yearbook, so they carried over material from a couple of school years into the following yearbook. The 36 yearbook carried some photos and revolved around the Threshing Stone visual image. It included several photos of the gathering. And the yearbook itself included several Threshing Stone design elements on the cover. And then interior design features. Some stickers were made up to distribute to students. But as you can see, they just didn't get it. They didn't understand the potential of the new symbol. And in this picture, you can see how the stones were located at one time, and how they were occasionally used. This is the 1941 homecoming queen, Lois Woodworth from Attica, Kansas. Despite being declared the official symbol, the Threshing Stone didn't really gain a secure place in Bethel visual symbolism. There were occasional usages. This is some 1941 letterhead. And yearbooks is another place where the Threshing Stone appeared more frequently. This is the 43 gray maroon. You can see how awkward it looks because this one has only six teeth. This is one of the best of the yearbook uses, the 48 gray maroon. Fairly elegant usage. I was going to show you a 1949 video clip here of a homecoming parade, which is another abandoned Bethel custom. We couldn't get that clip to work, so we'll have a few more homecoming floats a little bit later. Even in the 50s, though, nobody really got the hint. This is athletic department letterhead from 53. Here you can see the detail of the Threshing Stone. This Threshing Stone has eight teeth, so it's also wrong. This is one of the nicer usages of Threshing Stone imagery from the 50s, a 56 commencement invitation stationery. But with the later 50s, we'll start to move really into the heart of the story. In the late 50s, it seems like there was a certain amount of dissatisfaction with the gray maroon concept, or lack of concept. In the November 30, 1956 issue of the Collegian, Ted Zerger, one of the editors, posed a question for student comment. Should Bethel adopt a new athletic symbol? If so, what would you suggest? Six student responses were quoted, all persons from the classes of 1957 to 59. Only one favored keeping the gray maroon symbol. Two persons suggested buffalo or bison. Stop and contemplate that for a bit. The Bethel buffaloes, or the Bethel bison, that kind of has a ring to it, doesn't it? Some of you probably remember the bison that was in the window of the old Kauffman Museum years ago. We could put an exhibit case in the entry to Crable Science Center and put the bison back up again. The other students that commented on this question in 56 didn't have any specific suggestions. Jane Epp said, quote, somewhere in the student body should be some genius creative enough to design a mascot for dear old BC. We definitely need some tangible symbol, whether we keep the name of gray maroons or change the name. But if the name is changed, why not use some creativity there too and give our school a name, not necessarily realistic, but something no other school has, unquote. And Kathy Lorenz said, quote, I would like to be in favor of Bethel adopting a new athletic symbol. No appropriate symbol comes to my mind, but whatever the new one might be, I would suggest something a bit unique, unquote. Those two seem a little prophetic of the next couple of years. The December 15, 1956 issue of the Collegian, K. carried an unsigned brief article, "Does Team Need Change of Name?" The student council had opened a contest for the creation of either a gray maroon symbol or a new symbol. The prize was $20. Don't laugh too much, that would be around $135 in today's dollars. An editorial in the January 11, 1957 issue, just a few weeks later, endorsed the idea of a name change. Here it said that the Letter Club had initiated a campaign to change the symbol. And the March 1557 issue, just a few weeks later, added a threshing stone to the masthead without any other comment. The threshing stone masthead for the Collegian continued in some form for the next 30 years. We don't really know anything more about this flurry of interest in change here in 56 and 57. It could be that this was one of the proposals. You can see that the center is a 57, and that this little flyer advocates keeping the gray maroon as the team name. The June 57 issue of the Bethel College Bulletin, which was intended for the constituency rather than students, featured the threshing stone prominently without making any connection to athletic symbolism or other kinds of school symbolism. Inside the cover, you had the list of the standard cliches: the pioneering spirit, the simple life, faith, stability of character, hard work, cooperation, brotherhood. This is that representation that has the 8 teeth rather than the 7, so wasn't looked at as carefully as you might think. Nothing seems to have come of the movement for change in 56 and 57. It was really 3 years later that something more significant happened. In 1959, there was a beginning of a period of presidential transition at Bethel. David C. Wedel, who was C.H. Wedel's second cousin three times removed, Barry's fifth cousin three times removed. D.C. Wedel had been president since 52, following on the 20-year presidency of E.G. Kaufman. Judging from the written records, it seems that there was a somewhat negative mood at Bethel at the end of D.C. Wedel's presidency, sort of a sense of malaise or stagnation, various kinds of dissatisfaction, without really crystallizing around one major issue. Following on Wedel's resignation, the board appointed J. Winfield Fretz as interim president. Or this portrait, in a sort of faculty folly skit called "The Hair-Raising Adventure of Choosing an Acting President for Bethel College" in February of 1960. But let's go back to the more dignified portrait. Here's another one of the great personalities of Bethel's history. Fretz had taught at Bethel since 1942, but he was from eastern Pennsylvania originally, and thus an outsider to Bethel's local Kansas constituency. He had been active in sports in high school and looked back on that experience fondly. He was a sociologist, as were many other Mennonite academics from that time period, such as E.G. Kaufman also. Just before his appointment as interim president, he had spent the academic year in Paraguay on a research project. He returned to find himself appointed interim president. I suspect it might have been partly because he was absent during the preceding school year, and thus maybe less tangled up in whatever irritations the college community was feeling at the time. And by the way, in addition to his college teaching, Fretz ran a restaurant in Newton called the Guest House and was involved in anti-segregation efforts in the 50s. His restaurant apparently was the only one in Newton at the time he started it, that served customers of all races equally. Fretz was a vigorous, energetic personality and didn't seem to view the interim position just as a placeholder waiting for the new long-term president to arrive. He jumped into the position with energy, sort of like our most recent interim president. Fretz was also quite interested in athletics, as we said. He had been an active athlete in high school, a football player, among other things. Within the athletic department, according to one source, there was still some continuing undercurrent of wanting to change team names, probably still simmering from the 1957 discussion. The department already had a fairly long tradition of an annual Buffalo barbecue, and so the name Buffalo was at the top of the list. George Boer, the basketball coach and later athletic director, reportedly had some practice shirts made up with the name of the Bethel Buffaloes. It supposedly got some negative attention from Fritz, who thought Buffalo seemed to suggest slow and lumbering, but then he was from Pennsylvania. To get back to Fritz as a leader, he gave an opening school address on September 12, 1959, called The Recovery of a Cause, advocating the need for regaining a sense of institutional cause or vision. And he also organized a study group of faculty, administrators, and board members who were reading a book called The Idea of a College during the 59-60 school year. The Quaker theologian Elton Trueblood, the author of the book, argued that a college needed to focus on an idea, again, what we would now call a vision statement. In his search for fresh vision and administrative ideas for the college, Fritz turned to the Association of American Colleges, today the Association of American Colleges and Universities, a national organization for liberal arts colleges. This organization had begun an administrative consultant service whereby an outside consultant would be available to visit a college and bring a different set of experiences into contact with the institution. Fritz requested a consultant for Bethel, and the person assigned was Thomas E. Jones, a sort of Quaker counterpart to Bethel's E.G. Kaufman. Like Kaufman, Jones had been a missionary in the Far East and then a college president of Earlham Quaker School, and also had been president of Fisk University. Jones came to Bethel during March 1960. He was here for the Folk Festival, the predecessor to today's Fall Festival, so he would have seen various demonstrations of pioneer living and historical activities. Jones's response to his visit seems quite enthusiastic. He wrote a report of impressions and suggestions for Bethel. Reading the report nearly 50 years later, one finds his tone rather glib and some of his impressions just plain wrong. For example, he says that, quote, there is little or no architectural design on the campus, end quote. This despite the fact that the Ad Building was designed by the rising architectural stars of the 1880s, Proudfoot and Bird, who went on to found one of the most prominent architectural firms in the Midwest in the first half of the 20th century. And a successor firm under a different name still exists prominently in Des Moines. Jones also seemed quite optimistic about building positive relationships with the Newton community, what's often called the town-gown issue or relationship. But unfortunately, 1960 was only about 15 years after the very tense relationships of the World War II era, and just at the beginning of the even worse town-gown relationships of the Vietnam War era. But our main interest is in another element of Jones's report. He followed Fritz's lead in talking about a Bethel idea and offered a concrete symbol for it. Quote, fortunately, Bethel has a distinctive symbol which could be used to typify these values and make them relevant not only to its own heritage and constituency, but to the larger Kansas community in the world. This is the threshing stone in the shape of a roller whose ridges, when rolled over the wheat, separate the live kernels from the useless chaff and straw. Having experienced this type of threshing when heavy stones in the form of prejudice, incarceration, and torture were again and again rolled over them, the Mennonites can reveal afresh the life-giving power that is within them. Once more in the face of secularism, irresponsibility, crowd-mindedness, and authoritarian control, the imperishable qualities of life and light in the Mennonite faith and practice can be made apparent and compelling to society as a whole, unquote. It sounds really 50s-ish or Cold War-ish, doesn't it? Jones had such a good time at Bethel that he was invited back a few weeks later as the 1960 commencement speaker. Fritz said in a letter back to the Association of American Colleges right after Jones's visit, quote, from the time the Joneses landed on the campus until the moment they left, they had something significant to contribute. I think they set on fire our total college community in a way that has not been duplicated in the 18 years of my association with the college. One of the remarkable things was the way they were able to quickly size up the situation and see golden opportunities where many of us seemingly were too close to notice them. But the important follow-up to Jones's visit, as far as our questions today are concerned, came just a few days later in a chapel talk, March 21, 1960, by Winfield Fritz, titled, This Stone Shall Be a Witness. Chapel at that time was really a combination of what we experience now as separated into chapel and convocation. We don't really have a full text or recording of Fritz's talk, but his detailed outline allows us to reconstruct it pretty well. His title and the first part of his talk were a routine rhetorical gesture at the Bible. The title comes from Joshua 24:27. He comments about how stones are mentioned 40 times in the Bible, along with a comment about numerous references to threshing. And one of those verses, by the way, was Habakkuk 3:12. You have that one memorized, don't you? In the King James Version, it reads, Thou didst march through the land in indignation. Thou didst thresh the heathen in anger. Maybe that would make a good motto for Thresher athletic teams. And the modern translations aren't as interesting. Anyway, Fritz continued, All great causes need symbols. All colleges need them. Bethel College needs a symbol that fires the imagination, that calls forth loyalties and stirs the soul. Fritz argued that the threshing stone stands for something significant, suggests a process, something dynamic, that it has originality. There are thousands of wildcats, panthers, bears, lions, hundreds of bulldogs, braves. These are symbols of the caveman, the savage, the uncivilized. The threshing stone had widespread appeal. It suggests the ideals of industry, a symbol of motion, power, firmness. A gray maroon is hard to picture, he said. And the threshing stone is related to group history, as we've already talked about. Fritz didn't seem to be aware, or at least didn't mention, that the threshing stone had been declared an official symbol back in 1934. He concluded his talk again with a rhetorical gesture with the Bible, reading Joshua 24, 25 to 28, the verses that contain that famous phrase, "This stone shall be a witness." This chapel talk seems to be it. This is apparently the point at which the gray maroons vanished into mists of abstraction and the threshers began. But the implementation of this change is still a real mystery. There don't seem to be any memos or detailed instructions saying, stop saying gray maroon, start saying thresher. There's nothing in the faculty or board minutes, nothing in faculty staff bulletin, nothing in the daily announcements, nothing in the Bethel College bulletin, nothing in the collegian, but the switch was immediate and universal. The word gray maroon vanished from the vocabulary and memory of the Bethel community. Fritz, as an energetic interim president, changed Bethel's corporate culture drastically in a way that at the time he probably thought of as a minor public relations housekeeping matter. It would be interesting to speculate about how Bethel's experience of the 1960s might have been different if Fritz had stayed around. My sense is that Bethel's 60s weren't all that good an experience. What would it have looked like with this energetic and optimistic leader, someone who already had experience confronting the town and business community of Newton over difficult political issues and desegregation? Instead, he went on in 1963 to be the founding president of another Mennonite college, Conrad Grable, in Waterloo, Ontario. After the spring of 1960, of course, the threshing stone had a more secure and frequent place in Bethel's iconography, although not a constant one. In the early 60s, there was a flurry of threshing stone usages. Here's a photo already from the April 4, 1960 Buffalo barbecue athletic gathering. That's Dick Harp, basketball coach from KU, speaking. You can see the threshing stone on the pennant in the background. Presumably they were already using these. I don't think they had them made up just in the couple of weeks before the banquet, although I suppose that's possible. The collegiate started using a new threshing stone design on its masthead, or rather an old threshing stone design, replacing the 57 one that they had been using. This is pretty much the same as the one that appears on the 1950s letterhead and some earlier examples, still wrong with the 8 teeth rather than the 7. the actual threshing stones themselves, once in front of the old science hall, got moved around some in the 60s in a way that we aren't able to trace. In the early 60s, for example, one of them was in front of what was then the Kaufman Museum, located about where the bookstore is now. And I think that's probably the same one that we have here in front of us. Here's one particularly fascinating use of the threshing stone image. This is a 1963 brochure used as part of the fundraising effort for the Fine Arts Center. And inside, it explicitly makes reference to the threshing stone. You can see that we have the usual cliches, pioneer spirit and all that. And then on a further page, you can see that the Fine Arts Center is in fact a threshing stone, which I think is a very postmodern architectural concept. And this was the artist's conception of the Fine Arts Center. That looks a lot like the existing building, doesn't it? Here's another one, from that same time period when the Fine Arts Center was being planned. This campus planning presentation drawing shows the Fine Arts Center. If you can orient yourself, you see the Fine Arts Center down below here, the ad building, so the north is at the top here. The building that interests me especially is the one with the 8 lobes there. I really wish that one had gotten built. I wonder if that was inspired by a threshing stone. And the back of the April 1963 Mennonite Life, which focused on Bethel's 75th anniversary, had the more conventional threshing stone image for that time. Here are a couple of other usages. The 1963 homecoming float. And another 63 one, very quaint and yet also rather violent. And note that this one again has the wrong number of teeth on the threshing stone, so it looks odd for that reason. Here's a 64 homecoming float that's in front of what's now the MLA building, the old site of the library. Using a threshing stone as a bizarre bowling ball, Bethel strikes again. I don't know who the opponent was. They're represented by the goofy bird bowling pins. Here's a pen and ink drawing by Bob Regeer from 1966. Again, this flurry of usages in the early 60s. I wonder if this might have been a study for a logo possibility. There's also a string of yearbook usages, 66 and 67, a little bit more subtle usage, and a very 1960s looking 68 Thresher yearbook cover. The yearbooks became Thresher again in 1961 with the vanishing of the gray maroon terminology. In fall of 71, the Collegian then again switched its threshing stone symbol and adopted the one that had been used on the cover of the 68 yearbook. And who is Gower Champion anyway? And the 71 yearbook again returned to the threshing stone motif for the cover. Jumping ahead a little bit in the 70s, you've seen this image before from the early 60s, but I wanted to look at it again. This threshing stone was probably moved away from this spot in front of the museum only a couple of years after this photo was taken. But also note that the sign has a threshing stone on it. And for those of you who don't know, that the large window there was where the Bethel bison was displayed years ago. In 77, the Collegian adopted another form of the symbol. I wish I knew who designed this one. I think it was used pretty extensively in college publications in the late 70s, sometimes reversed so that the hitch angles to the left instead of the right. I think this is one of the nicer versions of the threshing stone logo. The Collegian used this version through the spring of 87, and since then there hasn't been a threshing stone on the masthead. There also seems to have been a gap in the usage of the threshing stone image in yearbooks after 1971, but the 1983 book designed by Scott Jost made extensive use of it, one of the more interesting examples of systematic use of a threshing stone imagery. The cover and in several places in the interior, this picture showing one current faculty member, for example, and the quotations that were used, again referring to the old themes. It appears that all of these 1983 stones have six teeth instead of the needed seven, which is kind of a major flaw in what otherwise is one of the most extended threshing stone usages. Now, coming to more contemporary instantiations of threshing stone visual imagery, there's this threshy humanoid from around the year 2000 or late 90s. If somebody can tell me who designed this one, I'd like to hear about it. It's been used in a number of similar variations. The most recent official instantiation of the threshing stone is by Ken Hebert, what is now called the legacy symbol. It appears on the 2001 yearbook, the first time in almost 20 years that the symbol was used for yearbook design. This version seems kind of dangerous, a half-ton block of limestone that appears to be whirling through space. But actually, there's another Ken Hebert version, this little one inside the BC fetus symbol. It looks like the brain with a spinal cord running down from it. And the legacy symbol variants continue to appear on college publications, such as when the periodical formerly known as the Bethel College Bulletin became Context in 2002 and took up a version of legacy symbol for its cover design. I suggested to Carla Reimer at the time that they not give the new publication a name, but just use the symbol as the title, but they opted for the more conventionally atmospheric Context. And that the legacy symbol appears in other, continues to appear in other Bethel publications, the 2007 Masterworks program, which uses the threshing stone as May flowers, which makes you wonder what kind of April showers created those types of May flowers. Our kind of threshing stone, a seven-toothed rolling cylinder of limestone, seems to be a uniquely Mennonite artifact, unique actually to a specific Mennonite subset, the Ukrainian Mennonites of the 19th century Russian Empire. I haven't found any occurrence of the stones outside of that Ukrainian Mennonite context. It's surprising to me that any physical artifact could be unique to such a small cultural group. The entrepreneurial energy that created Bethel College all came out of that particular Mennonite experience. So the threshing stone is a deeply embedded symbol for Bethel. Over the last few decades, we've often used the ringing of our famous bell for ceremonial occasions here. This dates back to Vietnam Moratorium Day, October 15, 1969, when Bethel appeared on national TV with the tolling of the bell. But the bell really has little long-term association with Bethel. It came from Meadows Mennonite Church out in Mingo, Kansas, and those conservative people were likely appalled at its use for political protest. It came to its prominence, I think, accidentally, as students pulled it out of the museum on a whim as a prop to use for the moratorium. And since then, of course, it has been used many times and has acquired a certain aura. But I'd like to conclude by suggesting something different, new and old. The rolling of a threshing stone, seven hammering strikes of stone, one complete revolution, would make a much richer connection to Bethel's story. Let's have the threshing stone as a new old element, a thresher ceremony and symbol. Thank you. I assume we'll take some time for questions and comments and so on. The two that are publicly displayed here on campus are this one, which is right in front of the ad building here, and then there's one in the bushes in at the entrance to the student center, and that one comes from Mound Ridge, from Roland and Fern Gehring in the early 90s sometime. And then there are at least two over at the museum, and you know, I'm not sure if one of those at the museum was one of the other two that was displayed in front of the science hall originally. And also, you know, don't know for sure which one of those came from Wedel and which one is the Dietrich Gadert stone, and you know, the sources weren't necessarily kept track of as they got shuffled around. I didn't see that shocker terminology used here at all. I would guess that's probably right, that one paragraph I quoted from the Kansan, I sort of wonder if that's the only round of making threshing stones that occurred, that one carload, meaning a train carload of threshing stones. I mean, that considering that there aren't that many of them around and that they weren't all that heavily used, I would guess that might be right, that there weren't, you know, a carload was all that were made here, and those have just been scattered around the countryside here. I can think of less than 10 that I've actually seen here in central Kansas, various places. Yeah, I have one, well, or my dad has one, and seen several in various other sites, either museum hands or private hands, various places. But like we said earlier, it's not a very handy antique to have, even if you think of it as, you know, aesthetically or intellectually attractive in some way. I'd have to think about that for a while. I'm not sure that would be true, would it? It's symmetrical in the sense that there's a tooth for every, you know, indentation. And pulling it with a horse or with an ox, there'd be a lot of shifting. And my theory about the number of teeth is that it primarily process in some way, I think, because there had been a sort of similar set of awards that were given a more generic name of something, you know, a Bethel College Academic Excellence Award or something like that. I don't remember the details, but there was, you know, there, I think there was an existing somewhat similar system that was then renamed as Thresher Award and modified in process in some way to become a little bit more prominent. It was sort of disconnected then from the recognitions that were given based purely on grade point average. You know, they had an old Order of the Golden A for a good number of decades that, you know, was based primarily, I think, on the student's GPA, and then the, you know, with the use of the Thresher Award terminology, I think that was separated and made more of a different kind of a special recognition. I'm not sure exactly what the story, full story is about the beginning of the Thresher Awards. I don't know a whole lot of details about that, but I know there was one incident in about, what would it be, maybe in 1980, 79, 80 school year, in which there was an anonymous message left on Harold Schultz's desk in the middle of the night requiring, or demanding that a new alma mater be written, that he come to convo and sing the old alma mater in public and then commission a new one in return for getting some of the contents of his office back that had vanished along with the appearance of the message. And rumor had it that he wanted to comply with the demand, but that other people didn't take it up so enthusiastically, and so I don't know of other attempts to revise the song. We sort of missed our opportunity to celebrate the centennial of the school colors. We still have a chance to celebrate the centennial of the song in a few years yet. Any other comments or questions? If not, I think we can adjourn for this evening. Sharon, did you want to say anything about the next faculty seminar in spring? I don't know the date, other than that it's in February. Yes, check the master calendar. It's in early February sometime, the next faculty seminar. And other than that, I think we can be dismissed this evening. Thank you all for coming. Oh, and I should also publicly thank Fred Unruh and whoever else helped him drag this threshing stone up here for us to look at while we were talking about it.
Mm-hmm. What's the construction? Is that limestone or is that...